Thank you very much, Andrew, and thank you especially for organizing this conference, which as always has been a great pleasure and inspiration to attend. I'm obviously going to be talking very briefly about a huge topic which contains the whole of religion. I'm going to try and approach it a little bit from the outside. I start from a simple view of prayer, of the kind that would be offered, I think, by Ludwig Feuerbach, the famous Hegelian, or young Hegelian, who tried to turn religion on its head, and who was such an inspiration to both Karl Marx and Richard Wagner. The gods, Feuerbach believed, are projections of our own aspirations and come into being through our desire to encounter in the objective world the subjective feelings that guide us. We put our own emotions and virtues into the gods in order to give those things a greater standing than they could otherwise acquire. And when we bow down and worship the things that we've created, in doing so we worship ourselves. Feuerbach didn't approve of this, since he believed that through this act of religious submission, we alienate ourselves from our higher nature, bestowing it on fictions of our own invention, and thereby separating our virtues from our material lives and making them unobtainable. This was especially true, he thought, of the Christian religion, in which the suffering God and the Virgin Mother are given a status that no human being could aspire to. Through worshipping the virtues of these divine persons, I excuse my moral indolence and reinforce my sense that because the ideal exists objectively in heaven, there's no need for it to exist subjectively in me. Now, on this view, in prayer, I ask help always from a being who is necessarily on my side, because that's why I invented him. Moreover, because the God is a symbol and manifestation of the good, I must ensure that what I ask is good. Asking the cooperation of a God in what is evil is the primordial religious offence and an invitation to punishment. However, in the literature of magic, there is the long story of black magic, the conjuring of spirits and devils who are not gods and whose fundamental designs in this world are evil. But you don't pray to such gods because you haven't objectified in them your higher yearnings. You strike bargains with them, like the bargain between Faust and Mephistopheles, and you'll always be the loser in the long run. Now, on this view, obviously, prayer is not just pointless, but it's also in some way demeaning. And moreover, it's not a special kind of speech act with a logic of its own, but a particular case of the general category of requests. So seeing prayer in this way, an atheist might respond that it is an irrational exercise, that there is no help forthcoming after all from the non-existent, and that the whole thing is based on self-deception. And as I say, Feuerbach would go further and say that prayer is not just pointless, but demeaning, since it locates the solution to our problems outside of ourselves and so encourages a renunciation of will and a loss of faith in our own power to improve things. Now, on the deist view, which we can associate with Spinoza, God is bound by the necessities that bind me, though he is conscious of them and therefore free. But it's irrational to think that God can be interested in my special requests. And Spinoza actually explicitly says this in the Ethics. And Voltaire likewise would argue that outside his role as creator, a role that we cannot in any case understand, at least on the model of our own actions, there is nothing for God to do in the world. He has set it in motion, endowed it with freedom, endowed us with freedom, and the rest is history. So all those views, the deist views, make it look as though prayer is a pointless activity, or worse, and as though those who think that there is a life of prayer, as many, as most Christians, I think, and who devote themselves to pursuing it, are deceiving themselves. If this is so, then not only is a large part of ordinary religious experience without foundation, the religious life itself is called in question. And in the face of that, many people have touched on the possibility that there might be intransitive prayers, so to speak, not prayers to a being, but at least prayers from a being, prayers from you, which, as it were, speed out from your distressed soul into the void. And you know that there is no specific place where they are aimed at going, but nevertheless that there is something in you that is improved by this. And I'll be talking around that conception all along. the main sort of embodiments of this view are really in literature and music and the arts. Rilke's sort of intransitive religion that you encounter in the Duino elegies is a bit like this. The Duino elegies are written in the language of prayer, but the prayer is not addressed to any deity outside us, but to things that come from within us, and perhaps to the earth, by way of eliciting from the earth something like a responding spirit to the spirit of the poet himself. But it is the poet's spirit reflected in that, in what he sees. Likewise, in Wagner's Ring Cycle, you have a wonderful realization in drama of an intransitive religion. Wagner was much influenced by Feuerbach and invented his gods on Feuerbach's principles. They are projections of the needs, yearnings, and aspirations of the human beings whom they torment. Prayer hardly occurs in the Ring Cycle, except once, in fact, when Brunhilde reveals to Sieglinde, who wanted only to die, that she is actually bearing Siegmund's child, at which moment Sieglinde launches into an incredible prayer of gratitude towards this goddess, who otherwise seemed to have been the instrument of disaster. And that is famously accompanied by a theme which returns at the end of the ring to tell us that that is actually the meaning of it all. It's all that we have, gratitude born out of suffering. But anyway, there are shared intransitive religions, and these are perhaps more important from our point of view. Religions without a personal god, and the Tibetan monastery is a house of prayer built around such a religion. A religion in which people pray all day, but not to anything, only from something, from themselves and their predicament, constantly going round and round the same old circle of repentance. And it's, funnily enough, it's that kind of Buddhism is not without its equivalent of special divine action. In the selection of the Dalai Lama himself is, as it were, an act of God, even though there is no God to perform it. A very strange thought, that. So as the Tibetan monasteries show, therefore, the idea of a personal god might be absent even when prayer is present. And that suggests that we really are dealing with a different speech act from the one that we know as asking. It is, in many cases, more like a rehearsal of something, as when a Buddhist recites the three jewels, or a Jew the Shem, or a Muslim the Shahada. People declare their faith, and in many standard prayers, this declaration is inseparable from the beseeching. In repeating the prayer, you are putting yourself in the presence of God, or in the case of Buddhism, turning yourself away from the world towards nirvana. You are reorienting yourself. And so that your ordinary desires and concerns are in some way discarded, or if they remain, transfigured and made compatible with your higher nature, your nature in the eyes of God, or as a disciple, or as a pilgrim on his way to nirvana. And I think this is where we should notice the existence of liturgical prayers, either as part of a standard liturgy, or as prayers that are repeated on a daily basis, perhaps again and again, like the Lord's Prayer and the Hail Mary. Although these prayers often include petitions, they have two other features that are of great importance. First, their fixed and liturgical character. They are composed of precise words, often words that have come down to us in language that is no longer current, or perhaps even no longer spoken. Secondly, they have the character of an affirmation. The Lord's Prayer, as you know, begins with a declaration of the status of God, followed by an act of worship, hallowed be thy name, and a command to himself from the person praying, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in other words, be done in me. Only when he has thus ordered himself in relation to God does the person who prays ask for anything, namely his daily bread, which is like a formal request for just about just to remain alive, which is immediately followed by the most important of the requests, the request for forgiveness and for guidance. Lead us not into temptation. You can understand these requests, in fact, in quite another way, namely as promises offered to God rather than petitions to receive something. We need forgiveness, but in the Lord's Prayer, we promise to forgive others, those who have trespassed against us, acknowledging that this is the price we must pay for being received again into God's love. And of course, when we ask not to be led into temptation, this is by way of promising God that we will resist temptation and strive in this respect too to deserve his love. These two features are even more clearly present in the Hail Mary, which is a hymn of praise to the Mother of Christ, concluding with a request that is again more like a promise than a petition. Pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. This is not a request for anything specific in this world, but for Mary's help in passing to the next. It is an acknowledgement of sinfulness and therefore of the fact that we do not deserve the grace for which we ask. It is also a recognition that the power of salvation does not lie with Mary, but with God. Mary's being asked to add her prayers to ours at the crucial moment. Even if you wish to construe this as a request, it is a request of a very unusual kind, which is again much more like a reorientation of the one who prays, a turning towards God, a readiness to be with him, and an acknowledgement of the real difficulty of praying. You're asking Mary to pray because you can't, and we don't know how to pray. And this prayer, therefore, is just for putting yourself in the hands of God, and it's one of the most dramatic moments in Verdi's representation, rewrite of Shakespeare's Othello, that he adds the Hail Mary with a few extra bits to the crucial moment when Desdemona is alone after having been, after putting herself to bed in a state of despair over her relations with Othello. And the interesting fact is that despite having put herself most beautifully in the hands of the Mother of God, she is promptly murdered. Another fact about prayer. Here's an interesting sonnet from our poet laureate, whose virtues are sometimes in question, but this, I think, is one of her better efforts. Some days, although we cannot pray, a prayer utters itself. So a woman will lift her head from the sieve of her hands and stare at the minims sung by a tree, a sudden gift. Some nights, although we are faithless, the truth enters our hearts, that small familiar pain. Then a man will stand stock still, hearing his youth in the distant Latin chanting of a train. Pray for us now. Grade one piano scales console the lodger looking out across a Midlands town. Then dusk, and someone calls a child's name as though they named their loss. Darkness outside. Inside, the radio's prayer. Rockall, Malin, Dogger, Finisterre. Now you all remember the shipping news, don't you? The shipping forecast on the radio, which is the only concrete example of a prayer that she gives, a machine-like sound in the background to your late night meditations. But that's a very rather wonderful invocation of the intransitive idea of prayer. Prayers sort of going up from not just from people, but from the radio and everything, without any particular reason to think that they will be answered. Liturgical prayers, however, have a completely different character. And that they don't suppose that God has the power or the inclination to intervene in specific ways at specific times. They are ways in which we bring ourselves into God's presence and acknowledge our weakness and incapacity. The help they ask for is the help that we ourselves provide through whatever strength of will we can, with God's help, muster. and God's help consists in the inner transformation that puts us on the level from which we can address him. And another way of putting this is to say that liturgical prayers are purifications, ways of discarding the pollution of our sinful ways so that our good intentions may once again emerge and be effective. That's really what crosses the mind of the lodger in that Midland town as he hears the piano scales. But there are specific spells, prayers too, and there's a real question what they are asking for. If we thought of religion as downstream from magic and prayers as downstream from spells, then we might suppose a prayer to be simply a way of summoning a god to one's aid. The priest or shaman has a particular powers in this respect, for the god that he summons is in the shaman's power. In other words, the shaman is not asking the god for something, he is commanding it. And this is an interesting feature of magic, one of the great differences between magic and religion. Magic is not an admission of weakness, but an assumption of strength. It is not humble, but arrogant, and it affects to bind the gods themselves to the will of humans, as Ariel is bound to the will of Prospero. Alchemy was, in that sense, a search for power, the power that would bring the secret spirits that influence human destiny under the control of those whom they otherwise might control. I would say that there is a great spiritual advance in the transition from magic to religion, and this advance consists in renouncing the attempt to control the world and learning instead to accept it. And all that is contained in the Lord's Prayer and in the reaffirmation of forgiveness as the Christian's primary duty. So prayers then are not spells, but we still do ask for things in our prayers. For cures, for illness, recovery of those whom we love, and the votive offering in which something is given to the god in order to attract his sympathy, survived from pagan times into the cult of the saints. We're all familiar with the chapels in Mediterranean countries where the silver images of legs, arms, and other limbs and organs hang, begging for assistance to their counterpart on the donor's body. Sometimes we ask for impossible things. The wife of the sailor lost at sea prays that he has not drowned, even though there is no way that even God can undo the past. The recent loss of the Malaysian airliner was the occasion of many such prayers, and they reminded us of a crucial fact that prayer is not just an expression of faith, it's an expression of hope. You pray for what you can hope for, and where there is no hope, prayer becomes impossible. So one way of looking at prayer of this kind, therefore, is as a hope lifted from the empirical world and offered for a blessing by the transcendental. It is a hope that stands at the edge of consecration, a hope to which another hope is added, the hope that God will turn his eyes towards it and give his blessing. Whatever can be hoped for can therefore be prayed for. The question is, what difference does it make? So it's helpful at this stage to distinguish two types of prayer. On the one hand, there are the prayers which are granted, or which can be taken as granted, through some inner process of my own. If I pray for the strength to resist a temptation, and when the hour comes, find that I am indeed able to resist it, then I might thank God for granting me the necessary strength. Or I might pray for forgiveness for something I've done, and by dint of praying, become convinced that I have been forgiven. This too is something for which I might thank God. In both cases, prayer has been effective because it has changed my state of mind in just the way that I wanted it to change. There is no need to assume, in addition, that God stepped in to bring about a condition that I could not have achieved on my own. I did achieve it on my own through praying. So at least the atheist will say, and I think many believers also. On the other hand, there is the prayer that asks for something that lies beyond my power to bring about merely by praying. I pray for peace in Syria, for instance, knowing that no action of mine could possibly bring it about. In the Anglican Church, before Holy Communion and during the intercession, bidding prayers are sometimes inserted into the liturgy. They tend to sound like a summary of the morning's news, usually with all the BBC prejudices still attached, telling God that there is work to do and he had better put his finger out and get on with it. But down the centuries, prayer has often been like this, a request that God change things by acting to bring about a precise result. We pray for the outcome we desire, for victory against our enemies, safety in times of pestilence. And what difference is made by such a prayer? Voltaire's ironical response was that God hears our prayers, but he's always on the side of the big battalions. The Old Testament and the Quran tell of victories in which God fights on the side of his chosen warriors, adding his invincible might to the battle, and so changing the course of events. In the history of Islam, this has been a critical foundation of the faith, and is becoming so again, alas. The belief that God grants victory to those who fight in his cause, and that defeat in battle is a sign that God has withdrawn his support. However, on this view, prayer is a self-justifying activity. If you pray for X and X is granted, that is the proof that God wanted X and therefore brought it about. If X is not granted, then that is the proof that God did not want X and therefore that you were wrong to pray for it. Prayer on this view is a matter of aligning yourself with God's will. You don't summon God's help in furthering your agenda, you add your strength to furthering his. When victory ceases to be granted, then you enter a period of doubt, not knowing whether you have read correctly the signs of God's purpose. And that period of doubt, which prevailed in the Middle East for 600 or 700 wonderful years, but alas, it's gone. On that view, prayer adds nothing to the world. God does not answer our prayers, since he does not intervene to change things in response to our request that he do so. His will remains above and beyond our beseeching, and all we can do is to study how to fit in to it. So he carries out his inscrutable purposes and leaves us free to join our will to his or not. Now, this is where I think a Christian perspective might help to push things on a little bit. In St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 11, verses 1 to 13, one of the disciples asked Jesus to teach us how to pray. And this was became the text of a rather wonderful Victorian hymn. And Jesus answers with the Lord's Prayer, implying it is just these words and sentiments that should be offered. He goes on to make strong claims for prayer. Ask and it shall be given, etc. In St. Matthew's Gospel, 21:22, he is reported as saying, "And all things, whatsoever ye shall ask in prayer, believing, ye shall receive." And yet he says nothing more about what we can ask than is implied in the Lord's Prayer itself, which is a prayer for forgiveness and guidance. To understand this, I think we should first address the question of God's action in the world, which Colin explored very subtly yesterday. Spinoza is right, I think, that God does not show his freedom by interrupting the natural order, for he is that natural order. If there are miracles, they should not be understood as violations of some law of nature, but as part of the unfolding order of God's purpose. True freedom lies within a purposeful order, the order that is exhibited when what happens has a reason and a goal. And I said some of this last night. We find freedom in the world whenever we encounter agency. In other words, whenever we encounter things that happen to which we can apply, as Elizabeth Anscombe puts it, a certain sense of the question why. Freedom means being able to account for ourselves in the first person, being able to answer the question why asked of our actions and movements, and being able to change our behavior in response to criticism. Freedom is not something we discover by looking inwards like an unforeseeable eruption. It is a shared practice based in our dialogue with others. In praying to God, we are assuming that this kind of dialogue can occur between us and him. And prayer must be understood in the first instance as one move in that dialogue, an opening move on the part of the sinner who begins, as he must, from contrition. I don't know what is meant exactly by special divine action in these circumstances, but I do know that what it would be for God to act freely in response to prayer. It would be for God to act as I act in response to another person's request for help, by ascertaining whether the person who seeks help also deserves it, whether I have reason to help him, and if so, what it is reasonable for me to do. When you and I engage in such a dialogue, reasons are explicitly formulated by both of us. and there is no doubt how things are resolved or why. It is not like that with prayer. Since God moves in mysterious ways, which is to say that his reasons are not stated but revealed, we understand God's acts by interpreting the world. And this means finding in God's overall purpose the reasons for what happens. Only when we understand that purpose can we know what we can expect in answer to our prayers. When Christ says, "Whatsoever you ask, believing, you shall receive," the crucial word is believing. Believing in God's purpose, and that means knowing that purpose in yourself. The believer cannot ask for just anything. His sense of God's purpose limits what it is rational to ask for. I cannot ask for eternal life in this world when I know that God's purpose is to redeem me from it. If I ask for revenge against my enemy, I cannot ask for this believing, since my belief informs me that no such reason can work with God. If we see prayer in this way, as the first move in a dialogue, in which the other person is not tongue-tied, but presenting his reasons in the language of revelation, we might begin to see how prayer makes sense. God, we are told, is love. His purpose is that we should love one another and resolve our conflicts through love and not through force and domination. It is in the light of that purpose that his reasons should be understood. If in my prayers I ask why I should be suffering, then I expect to be answered in a way that reconciles my suffering with God's love. If I pray for relief, it is because I believe that this suffering is not deserved and that God will see that this is so. All my most urgent prayers will be attempts to fit my life to God's purpose and to ask his help in doing so. And my prayers will be answered when I am at peace with events, when I have learned to want what is given to me and not to strain after what cannot be given. That, I think, is what is meant by God's grace, the opportunity to learn what is given to me and to learn to want it as God wants it. On that view, prayer loses the character of an impetuous wish list. It is not an attempt to call a supernatural force in aid of my worldly ambitions. God cannot be enlisted to my projects in the way that Sappho so beautifully enlisted Aphrodite to hers. In prayer, I am addressing God as a supplicant because his reasons are unclear to me. I'm seeking to make sense of this world and to find my own place within it. And the transformation achieved by prayer is a transformation in me. In effect, prayers are so often granted when sincerely made for the reason that those requests that can be made from the posture of belief are requests that are answered in the act of making them. The urgent and penitent request for God's forgiveness is the kind of thing that brings the sense of being forgiven by God. The believing prayer for help in times of suffering is the laying bare of suffering that is the first step to relief from it. When prayers are not answered, it is in many cases because they are not prayers that can be made sincerely, as in my attempt to make God share my ambition for wealth, longevity, or sexual conquest. Sappho can sincerely ask for Aphrodite's help, because this is the goddess's speciality and part of her plan. She was offended, remember, by the chastity of Hippolytus. Perhaps it is best to end here, however, with a sonnet by George Herbert, entitled simply Prayer, in which he reviews all the ways in which prayer surges in the human heart, in good ways and bad ways and so on, in a catalogue of descriptions, ending with two words which express his own quiet view of the matter. Prayer, the church's banquet, angels' age, God's breath in man returning to his birth, the soul in paraphrase, heart in pilgrimage, the Christian plummet sounding heaven and earth, engine against the Almighty, sinner's tower, reversed thunder, Christ's side piercing spear, the 6 days' world transposing in an hour, a kind of tune, which all things hear and fear, softness and peace and joy and love and bliss. Exalted manner, gladness of the heart, heaven in ordinary, man well-dressed, the Milky Way, the bird of paradise, church bells beyond the stars heard, the soul's blood, the land of spices, something understood.
Very much. Roger. We've got about 10 minutes for questions. I think someone's got the microphone. I hope someone's got the microphone. Thank you. If you'd just like to wait until the microphone reaches you. And Richard, you're first.
Thank you for that very elegant presentation of a certain view of prayer. And I'm sure that there is a great deal of that in the Christian understanding of prayer. But there is an awful lot in the Christian understanding of prayer as petitionary prayer, asking God to do something that he wouldn't otherwise do, to interfere in the normal course of events, or if the normal course of events is not already, as it were, arranged in advance, to direct it in one direction rather than another. And it's very difficult to avoid that suggestion that that is a very central core of Christian petitionary prayer. Now, I can understand someone who wants to be involved in the life of prayer and doesn't believe that God either does or can affect the course of history to try and understand prayer in that way. But I mean, look at innumerable examples in the New Testament, especially of unanswered prayer. St. Paul's prayer to be removed, to have this thorn in the flesh removed. Three times he asked the Lord, and the Lord refused him. Of course, St. Paul understood that the Lord had good reasons for refusing him, but still, it was a refusal to do something which clearly the Lord could do. Now, I understand also behind some of what you're saying, a certain moral feeling that somehow or other we shouldn't be asking for things, but we should accept what God has provided. But surely a loving God would want to interact with us, and the Christian view of God is as a friend, in St. John's words, and interaction means doing something that you wouldn't do unless you had been asked. If I treated my children in the sort of way that you are suggesting that God treats us, they would deeply resent it. Sure, my children may ask for things, and if I don't think they're good things, I will not grant their request. But surely I think it a good thing to grant a request if there's no reason not to. And certainly I would do certain things for my children which I wouldn't do if they hadn't asked. And that is a mark of treating them as individuals and respecting them. And if God doesn't treat us like that way, I think that's a very view of religion which treats us as sort of pawns in God's game, really. And so I regard this as a very inadequate view of petitionary prayer.
So pawns in God's game. Roger, I'd like to respond to that.
Yes, well, that was less a question than the assertion of a rival point of view. As all I should say in response is that I think your point of view is wrong. Of course we ask, there are petitionary prayers, I don't want to deny this, and they can be granted, but I wanted also to say that the primary point of prayer is to put you in that relation with God from which it makes sense to ask, to put the asking first rather than the orientation of towards God first is to get things the wrong way round. Most people, I think, have great difficulties in knowing how to affect that orientation towards God, which is why the disciple asked Christ, you know, to teach us how to pray. And the prayer that he taught us is one which is about putting ourselves in the right relationship so that things can begin. And if you look at the example that I took of the Tibetan monastery, there is nothing else to prayer than that.
So we might have time for one more question. I wouldn't mind making a quick comment at the end. That's it, Tim.
Tim Tim McGrew, Western Michigan University. I'm sympathetic to both sides of attention that I hear here in the interplay between you and Richard Swinburne, between the petition and the orientation. Of course, in Luke 22, Christ famously prays, "Let this cup pass, nevertheless, not my will but thine." I'm wondering if we might find a way of harmonizing these in the 1928 Book of Common Prayer with that, that wonderful line that says, "And that we may receive those things for which we ask, teach us to love those things which thou dost command." Mm.
Very good. Yes, I mean, insofar as there is any wisdom in the Christian religion, it's contained in the Book of Common Prayer.
We have to go on to Ray Tallis soon, but I'd like to just make a quick comment, not so much to you, Roger, but perhaps to Voltaire, this comment about the big battalions, and to express why some believers might respond to that, come back on that, because it's a case of Napoleon. Napoleon famously boasted to the clergy of Rome that he could lift his little finger and destroy the church, to which the cardinals are reputed to have remarked, "We've been trying to do that for 2,000 years and we haven't succeeded." But of course, just a few miles down the road, Napoleon III is buried under Farnborough Abbey, where the monks pray for his soul. Now, you see, one of the interesting things about God being on the side of big battalions is, when you take the bigger picture, it's interesting what happens in the end. Mm. And that's why Dante is very curious on this. Most people get the desires of their heart. It's interesting to see how the purposes work out in the end. So believers might be able to respond without quite such a sense of negativity with regard to the answering prayer when you see the big picture, the narrative come to its end. Any comments on that?
Well I will only refer to Voltaire just to remind you of a thought that crosses everybody's mind. And of course, in the 20th century, if we look back at the horrors and remember those the millions of prayers sent up from the camps to no effect, you know, we naturally think, gosh, what's the point? But you're right. In the greater picture must, if faith has to have a meaning, it must have another aspect, and this is beautifully represented by Tintoretto in his Crucifixion in the Scuola San Rocco in Venice, you know, where you see the huddled forms of the disciples at the foot of the cross, defeated, everything empty, but the great cross above them, bearing the promise of redemption. And that of course is what it's all about in the end. It is fundamental for Christian religion, what in my view a mark of its superiority over Islam, is that it makes defeat part of God's purpose too.